और
हाँ
हाइपरटेंशन, एपिडेमियोलॉजी, हाउ टू डिफाइन हाइपरटेंशन, हाउ टू रिकॉर्ड हाइपरटेंशन, हाउ टू मेक अ डायग्नोसिस ऑफ हाइपरटेंशन एंड व्हाट आर द वेरियस टर्मिनोलॉजीज लाइक व्हाइट कोट हाइपरटेंशन, मास्कुलर हाइपरटेंशन, व्हाट आर द इमरजेंसीज, मैलिग्नेंट हाइपरटेंशन, हाइपरटेंसिव इमरजेंसी, अर्जेंसी, हाउ द टारगेट ऑर्गन्स आर डैमेज्ड, हाउ I've been covered by me in the last class. Now, so today it's an important issue. I will let you know how to evaluate, once you make a diagnosis of hypertension in patient, how to approach for investigations and how to plan for treatment and what the health education you have to give to the patient. And also, there are some special situations where the hypertension has to be covered. It will be covered in today's class. So what are the things you have to examine? In the history, first of all, you should take any family history of hypertension, any family history of sudden cardiac deaths, and history for risk factors like smoking, alcohol, etc. has to be recorded, which I have covered in the last class. And in physical examination, you have to record his weight and height for recording the BMI. So BMI has to be calculated. And of course, waist and hip circumference also needs to be calculated. That's an important issue because this BMI is also having a bearing on tension. This is also one of the risk factors. Already told in the last class. And then in examination, cardiovascular system examination, the markers for hypertension like apex, prominent second sound, A2, presence of an S4 has to be present. And any bruise, the carotid bruise, any renal bruise, vascular hypertension, and the pulse has to be recorded, peripheral pulses for evidence of peripheral vascular disease has to be recorded. And in addition, the pulses and blood pressure may give you a hint about coactation of aorta. And neurological examination for any deficits, which may suggest ischemia or and the cognitive status of the patient for documenting the emergency like hypertensive encephalopathy has to be recorded. Fundus has to be seen for evidence of hypertensive changes, which I told you the last time as 4 grades. Then the blood pressure has to be recorded in both arms as well as in lower limb. This will give a clue about the coarctation of aorta. The skin for any neurofibroma, for evidence of like to carefully spot neurofibromatosis may suggest a pleochroma. Abdominal palpation may give a clue about a polycystic disease of the kidney, which may be a secondary cause of hypertension. And of course, the phenotypic features of secondary hypertension I told you in the last class. The thyroid disease has also to be excluded because both hyper and hypothyroidism can predispose hypertension. So in routine evaluation, you have to do, apart from routine things, the diabetic status of the patient has to be assessed. Risk factors like any dyslipidemia has to be estimated. Electrolytes, especially potassium and sodium, has to be measured. Uric acid can be an important marker for hypertension, has to be measured. Kidney function by means of creatinine and also the eGFR has to be measured by means of estimated glomerular filtration by formulas. Liver function tests, because this is important to start when you are starting some of the drugs. The baseline liver function tests may be essential. And urine microscopy. It's well said, urine microscopy is a poor man's liver biopsy, it's called. More about CKD by means of any precipitates, presence of an RBC will suggest any glomerular disease, like glomerulonephritis, etc., which may be a cause for hypertension. Albumin creatinine ratio, which will give a marker for the CKD. And then a baseline ECG has to be recorded. In that patient is prone for arrhythmias, especially AF is common in hypertensives. So presence or absence of arrhythmias has to be recorded by means of an ECG. And also evidence of left ventricular hypertrophy can be seen, can be recorded by means of ENE electrocardiogram. Of course, in some other patients where echocardiography, carotid Doppler, renovascular Doppler also needs to be done in when the patients in resistant hypertension. When you made a diagnosis, when you have detected the target organ damage, after recording all these things, then you have to plan for management. Why treatment is, what is the importance of treatment? Why you want to treat it all? It has been found that a reduction of around 10 to 5 millimeters of mercury blood pressure will have a lot of bearing on health. For example, the CV events, the coronary events will be reduced by 20%. The all-cause mortality is reduced by around 10 to 15%. The stroke itself will get reduced by, the chance of stroke also will fall by 32%. And heart failure reduces by around 40%. And there will be slowing of progression of chronic kidney disease. So these are all the beneficial effects of management of hypertension. So in view of these immense benefits, the patient has to be started on treatment. Then what are the options? The options are lifestyle changes, there are drugs, and some other recent developments are also there. Now I will dwell on these three options and how to plan for drug treatment. I will go ahead with now. So what are the lifestyle changes we should suggest? A reduction of BMI will reduce the blood pressure, and it also increases the insulin sensitivity and favorably predisposes for control of hypertension as well as diabetes. So a BMI has to be recorded if it is definitely more than 30 kg per square meter, then patient has to be counseled regarding the importance of weight reduction. Weight reduction, especially the central body obesity, abdominal obesity, or the apple belly obesity called, is more predisposed towards adverse cardiac as well as coronary events. So patient has to be counseled about the importance of reducing his weight for a period of 3 months or 6 months. And you know what is a metabolic syndrome? I told you in the last class what is metabolic syndrome. So this high weight, insulin sensitivity, hypertension, diabetes, all these things will also get controlled with treatment. So weight reduction is an important part of management. Then salt reduction. The salt reduction, unfortunately, in our part of the region, salt consumption is very high. Usually this salt is consumed by adding to the food and also by means of processed foods, especially the Lays, Kurkure, pickles, papad. These are all some of the things which will give lot of salt, hidden salt will be more in them. As per WHO, around 5 grams of salt is the maximum which one can take. So that amounts to a sodium chloride of around 2 grams, that is 1 teaspoon, half table, that's around 5 grams. It will give around 2 grams of sodium chloride. So that is what is meant by salt restriction. So salt restricted diet will favorably predispose to the control of hypertension. Then alcohol, stopping of alcohol, I don't suggest moderate. So better to stop alcohol, though moderation is suggested, nobody will stop at that level. So stoppage of alcohol is suggested. Regular physical activity is very much lacking, especially in younger generation now. At least you must take 30 minutes of rigorous exercise, that is aerobic activity. What do you mean by that? At least 30 minutes of brisk walking. Then what do you mean by brisk walking? When you are doing brisk walking, you are not able to talk to your friend who is walking along with you in a complete full sentence. That is called as brisk walking. Like that, you have to walk for a minimum of 20 to 30 minutes per day, 5 to 7 days in a week. That is called as regular aerobic physical activity. And of course, smoking and smoking related tobacco products has to be absolutely stopped. Diet, there is what is called a DASH diet, that is dietary approach to stop hypertension, which is nothing but lot of fruits and vegetables, low amount of saturated, very least amount of saturated fat, and more amount of low fatty dairy products. This is what is called as DASH diet. This is supposed to be beneficial for patients of hypertension. Then if the patient is taking any OC pills or any hormonal drugs for HRT, patient has to probably has to really think that whether to continue or not, because this also can lead to hypertension. This is already covered. And then waist circumference of more than 102 and more than 188 in men and women are supposed to be having an adverse effect. But for Indians, probably the waist circumference of less than 94 for men and less than 8 centimeters for women has to be taken into consideration. It's already occurred. So this is about lifestyle changes. So the lifestyle changes includes diet, weight reduction, salt reduction, alcohol, smoking, etc. So, and regular physical aerobic activity like walking, swimming, cycling, etc. Then when the lifestyle changes are not able to bring an expected level of reduction in blood pressure, probably you have to go for drugs. There are so many drugs, diuretics, angiotensin convertase inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, calcium channel blockers, beta blockers, alpha blockers, central sympatholytics, direct vasodilators, these are all some of the drugs. Further, there are some of the drugs which are available for emergency, but also I will tell. So all these things have already been covered to you in your pharmacology, but still, as an overview, I will briefly tell how to use, where it is indicated, how to construct a regimen. Now I will tell. First thing you should remember is all these groups have equal, especially the top five ones, diuretics, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, calcium channel blockers, and beta blockers. These five groups, almost all are having equivalent BP lowering effects as a monotherapy. Let me tell again, all these five group of drugs have equivalent BP lowering effects as a monotherapy. Then what to be taken as an issue? And see, this, the choosing of drug depends upon their risk factors. Some of the compelling indicators I will tell you. And younger people will respond to ACE inhibitors and beta blockers better than an elderly people. Elderly people will respond better to calcium channel blockers. An isolated systolic hypertension in elderly, calcium channel blockers are important drug selection. So the comorbidities will influence selection. For example, presence of recurrent angina, post MI, asthma, peripheral vascular disease, COPD, or pregnancy. These are some of the things which will influence you to select one among these five groups of drugs. ACE inhibitors and ARBs are renoprotective. Patients in hypertension, heart failure, diuretics, AC and ARBs have a survival benefit. So based on all these presence options of the comorbidities, you have to take the selection. So based on the age, the race, or presence and options of comorbidities and some symptoms, you have to choose one among the drug and then slowly titrate to the higher doses, tolerable doses. Then what drug to start first? As per JNCI-7, AC or ARBs are the drugs to be started. In the beginning, as per NICER, Hypertension Society of the British Hypertension Society, less than 55 years, it is ARBs or ACE inhibitors. Above 55 years, it is ACE blockers. As the first drug. Of course, a diuretic or beta blockers has to be taken later on, they have to be added. So if you want to take a monotherapy, as per British Hypertension Society guidelines or NICE guidelines, less than 55 years, you can choose ACE inhibitors or ARBs. Above 55 cc blockers, or you can change the diet also as a monotherapy. You want to combine as an initial therapy, either AC inhibitors may be combined with CC blockers or diuretic, or CC blockers may be CC blockers may be combined with the diuretic or AC. So this is the combination. Suppose if it's not getting controlled, then the step two. See, for the first one is when to start, when to go for step one, step two, I will tell later. First, how to combine, I am telling. So, 55 years, above 55 years can be taken as as per British Hypertension Society guidelines, or JH-17 also will tell AC inhibitors, will tell choose AC inhibitors. So, choose AC inhibitor. If you want, you can add a CC blocker or a diuretic, not control. Or you can choose a CC blocker and a diuretic or AC. Then, step two becomes a triple combination. These two plus a diet. AC inhibitor, CC blocker, and diuretic. Then step three, all these things, including lifestyle changes, there is, you are not able to control to the target, then probably you have to take the step three. The step three is you have to take fibronectin. And beta blocker can be considered at any level, at any step, when there is a specific indication. What are the indications for beta blocker? Heart failure is an indication, recurrent angina is an indication, post-MI, yes, you have to do. Arrhythmia, especially atrial fibrillation, SVT, younger woman, planning for pregnancy where AC inhibitors are contraindicated. These are the patients where beta blockers has to be aggressively considered for starting, either starting or adding at step four, step three. So let me tell again, so as a monotherapy, you can choose anyone among the five, depending upon the compelling indication and clinical condition of the patient, tolerability of the patient. Either AC inhibitor or CC blockers or a diuretic therapy can be started as a monotherapy after lifestyle changes have exhausted and not able to bring it to the target level. Then you add them. Then in the step three, it becomes a triple combination, both AC or ARB plus CC blocker and diuretic. Then the step three is resistant hypertension. How to take decision, how to treat resistant, I will tell that. So now, let me tell briefly about a review of the drugs. What are the drugs available? Number one is diuretics. In this, see, diuretics include thiazide diuretics, thiazide-like diuretics, potassium-sparing diuretics, loop diuretics. So many classes are available. But for hypertension, we use thiazide and thiazide-like diuretics. Very low doses are used. They can be used either monotherapy or in combination. How they work? They work in the distal convoluted tubule by inhibiting sodium chloride pump. By that, they facilitate sodium excretion. What are the drugs available? Hydrochlorothiazide and chlorothalidone. Thiazide-like diuretics, indapamide. The important side effects of these group of hypokalemia, they can cause insulin resistance, increase cholesterol. Then potassium sparing diuretics. Weak potassium sparing diuretics, trimethoprim nimleride, loop diuretics. When to add loop diuretics, I'll tell later. Then, as a monotherapy, when the patient develops hypokalemia, go for potassium sparing diuretics like trimethoprim. Though they are weak, they can be given trimethoprim and amiloride can be added. If the eGFR reduces below 30, probably you have to go for loop diuretics. So that is the indication for loop diuretics. When the eGFR is less than 30, or the patient is having acute congestive decompensated heart failure, presence with acute pulmonary edema, resistant hypertension, is acute MI, these are the conditions where loop diuretics can be started for a short while. The second group of drugs are calcium channel blockers. These calcium channel blockers, there are two groups in it, dihydropyridine and non-dihydropyridine. The dihydropyridine group includes the very widely used amlodipine, lipodipine, etc., which are having long acting and they're very safe drugs. They are widely used. Non-dihydropyridine, again, there are phenylalkylamines and benzothiazines. The phenylalkylamine group is verapamil, benzodiazepine group is exemplified by diazepam. One important point to remember about non-dihydropyridine group, that is the verapamil and diltiazem, is these should not be combined. You must be cautious when combining with beta blockers because they can potentially reduce the heart rate. Then what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? They reduces vascular resistance through L-channel blockade. What are the important side effects? They can cause flushing, headache. They can cause fatal edema, and this edema is not due to fluid retention. It is due to elevation of the transcendental pressure. They can cause gingival hypertrophy also, especially amlodipine. So these are some of the side effects of calcium channel. So calcium channel blockers act through vascular resistance through L-channel blockade. There are two groups, dihydropyridine, non-dihydropyridine. Non-dihydropyridine is verapamil and diltiazem. dihydropyridinase, verapamil, amlodipine, and nifedipine. Then come to beta blockers. In these beta blockers, they lower the blood pressure by reducing cardiac output, heart rate, and contractility. It also inhibits insulin release. Here they are classified variously depending upon their solubility. But we are interested only whether they are selective or non-selective, whether they have intrinsic sympathomimetic activity or not. This is what we are important. For treatment of hypertension, those we select usually the selective ones, those specifically act on beta 1, those who have no intrinsic sympathomimetic activity are preferred. So these are called as cardioselective drugs without intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. What are they? They are exemplified by atenolol, metoprolol, and esmolol. This is one group. So we are not interested in non-selective drugs. They are propranolol, timolol, sotalol, etc. We are not bothered about here. So cardioselective beta blockers without intrinsic sympathomimetic activity are the drugs which are widely chosen for management of hypertension. They are atenolol, metoprolol, and esmolol. Then there is one more group of drugs which are both alpha and beta blockers. They are carvedilol and labetalol. What are the contraindications for beta blocker? Acute severe asthma, peripheral vascular disease, acute decompensated heart failure. So these are some of the contraindications. Heart block, bradycardia are some of the contraindications. The specific indications I already told you, postpartum, recurrent angina, in patients where basically because cannot be given like pregnancy, etc., they can be given. So these are some of the indications which I already told you. Then coming to AC inhibitors, I told you in the last class the mechanism of renin converting enzyme and how it's formed from aldosterone to how the renin converts, how converting enzyme converts 1 to 2, and what the angiotensin 2 will do. This itself is a vasopressor, I told you. This acts on angiotensin 1, it's called vasopressin release. This is antidiuretic as well as antinatriuretic. So by all these methods, it causes hypertension. It increases the blood pressure. That is angiotensin 2. So if you give a converting enzyme inhibitor or angiotensin receptor blocker, these effects are contracted. Jaynes 7 suggests it as an initial drug. And the compelling indicators for AC inhibitors are heart failure, post-MI, diabetes mellitus, CKD, and recurrent stroke. In all these patients, this is supposed to have a favorable effects. And it doesn't have any adverse effect on the lipid. And it improves insulin sensitivity and glucose intolerance. That's why in diabetes, these are the preferred drugs. It also decreases the proteinuria. That's why in CKD also, this can be given. The side effects. The side effects of this are hyperkalemia, cough. They're absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. So these are the conditions where you have to go for other drugs. And also in bilateral renal stenosis, these are absolutely contraindicated because these drugs will cause vasodilatation of the efferent arteriole and causes CKD and causes renal failure. That's why in pregnant women and bilateral renal stenosis, this is renal artery stenosis, this is absolutely contraindicated. The ARBs will selectively and competitively block the angiotensin receptor 1. Then examples for AC inhibitors are enalapril, ramipril, enalapril, lisinopril, etc. The common examples for ARBs are telmisartan, losartan, valmisartan. These are very commonly used drugs. Indications, contraindications, I think I have covered. And there is one more group of drug. You can inhibit directly renin. This group of drug is called aliskrin, direct renin inhibitors. They have a similar action as ACs and ARBs. So this is direct renin inhibitors called aliskrin. Then what are these aldosterone antagonists? You know the mechanism of production of aldosterone. There are two aldosterone selective and non-selective antagonists are there. This aldosterone binds to progesterone and it's antiandrogen. That's why the patient will develop gynecomastia, impotence, and one more side effect is hyperkalemia. What are the indications for these drugs? These drugs are specifically indicated in low renin primary hypertension and in primary aldosteronism and resistant hypertension. Also, this can be used. And a selective aldosterone antagonist is eplerenone. And this drug also can be used, though this is not an out of place to tell, for diagnosis of primary aldosteronism. This can also be used in what is called as a long test and short test. We give this drug for 100 milligrams for 1 month, 100 to 200 milligrams. If it controls hypokalemia and hypertension in 1 month, probably you have to suspect primary aldosteronism. But the short test is, there is what is called long test and short test. The short test is we give in a suspected patient this drug, aldosterone, for 4 days, then stop and see. In these 4 days, if the hypokalemia is corrected, hypertension is getting down, and after stopping, patient is again going back, probably this is the case of primary aldosteronism. Then there are so many other drugs, alpha and adrenergic blockers, sympatholytics, vasodilators, loop diuretics, I already told you where they are. Furosemide, lumetanide, furosemide, etc. Alpha adrenergic blockers, there is what is called as, in alpha, there is an alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptors. Alpha 1 and alpha 2 can be blocked by a group of drugs called as phenoxybendamine and phentolamine. These drugs are now not available, because they are used for pheochromocytoma. There is what is called as a selective alpha 1 blockers. They are called as prednisolone derivatives. There are prazosin, terazosin, doxazosin, prazosin short-acting, terazosin, doxazosin, or long-acting. These are the additional drugs in patients. They are not the first-line drugs. They are probably the third or fourth-line drugs. They can be given in some specific indications like BPH, in patient resistant hypertension, where it is not being controlled by other three drugs. I will tell about resistant hypertension later. And these are metabolized in liver, and so no dosage adjustments are required in renal disease. So that is the advantage. So alpha 1 blockade, 1 and 2 blockade is phenoxybendamine. Specific alpha 1 blockers are prazosin, terazosin, and doxazosin. Then central sympatholytics, they are agonists at the brainstem. They are clonidine and methyldopa. They are central sympathetic agonists. Then direct vasodilators are hydralazine, minoxidil. I will tell about them, where it is used, and I will tell about them. Then there are some parenteral agents like sodium nitroprusside, nitroglycerin, labetalol, nicardipine, levodopine, esmolol, enalapril and hydralazine. Of these, I think sodium nitroprusside, nitroglycerin, labetalol is available. Esmolol is also available for us. Rest of the things are not available for us. Then how to use sodium nitroprusside? This is widely available. Very short acting drug. It's a direct vasodilator both on arteries and venous system. It decreases both preload and afterload. It has very minimal effect on cardiac output and myocardial blood flow. So that is one advantage. Very rapidly acting. Its action lasts only for 3 to 5 minutes. When you are giving this drug, you have to protect it from sunlight. So you have to put a shade in the saline bottle. How to use this? You have to start at 0.25 micrograms per kg per minute. And then you can titrate for every 5. For example, you take 500 ml of dextrose, 1 pint of dextrose, add 50 milligrams. That will give, 1 ml will give 100 micrograms of sodium nitroprusside. 1 ml means 60 microdrops. So 60 microdrops will give 100 micrograms. So 6 microdrops will give 10 micrograms. So for example, you take around 60 kgs man or woman. So 60 into 0.25 comes to around 15 micrograms. So you have to give 15 micrograms means 10 micrograms is 6 drops, 6 microdrops. So if you do 9 microdrops as a bolus, that will come to around 15 micrograms. So then every 5 minutes, you can enhance to a maximum of 2 to 3 micrograms. So you have to dilute 50 milligrams in 500 ml of dextrose. 1 ml will give 100 micrograms. That is 60 microdrops will give 100 micrograms. 6 microdrops will do 10 micrograms. Like that, you have to titrate, you have to put a shade. You cannot use these drugs for more than 3 days, because This will cause thiocyanate, intoxication, and cyanide poisoning. That can be suspected when the pH blood the pH falls, can suspect poisoning, toxicity, sodium hypochlorite. So these are the drugs which can be given in acute severe hypertension or hypertension emergencies and urgencies. Nitroglycerin, again, one more drug, arterial venous dilator, dilates coronaries, that's why it's specifically indicated in acute MI or post-myocardial infarction, again 50 to 100 micrograms per minute, useful in acute coronary syndromes. Labetalol is available for us. This is, as already told you, labetalol and carvedilol are alpha and beta blockers. This has to be given around 20 to 80 milligrams bolus every 10 minutes. So a maximum of 2 milligrams per minute infusion. That you can give. This is a very safe drug. Unless otherwise contraindicated with asthma, bradycardia and heart block, this can be given. This can be given in pregnancy and delivery also. There are some oral agents available. For example, clonidine, 0.2 milligrams orally and 0.1 milligrams every hour up to a maximum of 0.8 milligrams. This is also available as a patch of 1.1 milligrams. And you have to attach this patch into a non-hairy zone. Once in a week, you have to change this patch and you have to up-titrate. You can go up to a maximum of 0.6 milligrams. You have to give 1 week time, then you can change the patch. It's available as 0.1 milligram patches, which can be applied to a non-hairy zone. Captopril 12.5 to 25 milligrams is the dose, and nifedipine is available. Nifedipine, it should not be given sublingually because it causes sudden fall. And what are the problems with sudden fall? I will let you know now. This can be given as a sustained release preparation. Then there are some situations where you have to do special situations, like primary aldosteronism, iatric aneurysm, perioperative state, Cushing syndrome, resistant hypertension, eclampsia, and hypertensive emergencies and crisis. Emergency, urgency, or what is called as acute severe hypertension. So these are the conditions where these parenteral drugs are replaced. Now, primary aldosterone. This is a cause for hypertension or sometimes resistant hypertension. How to suspect this? To suspect hypertension in a patient of unprovoked hypokalemia. Usually, hypokalemia we expect in patient who is taking diuretics or who is having vomitings and diarrhea. But without all these things, patient is not on diuretic, he is hypertensive, patient develops hypokalemia. Only this is the group of patients where you have to suspect primary aldosteronism. And you have to make a diagnosis clinically because it's a curable form. It is due to increased aldosterone production from independent of reticular renin angiotensin system. Hypokalemia, hypertension, and low plasma renin activity. And edema is not seen here in these patients. So how to diagnose? You have to measure the aldosterone, that is aldosterone, and renin activity, plasma renin activity, and you have to make a ratio. If the ratio of aldosterone and renin activity is more than 30 is to 1, with an aldactone concentration of more than 555 picograms or more than 20 nanograms, then it is diabetes. So if the aldosterone production is more, the aldosterone concentration is more than 20 nanograms per 100 ml, this is one. And I already told you long test and short test. That's also one method of diagnosing primary aldosteronism, by using this aldosterone metabolic like spironolactone. Cushing syndrome, the phenotypic, by seeing the patient, you can make a diagnosis of Cushing syndrome. Excessive cortisol production can be documented. It may be due to because of ACTH production from pituitary, it may be a tumor, or from an ectopic site. How to diagnose 24 hours excretion of urinary free cortisol or overnight dexamethasone suppression test. This is the two tests by which you can make a clinical diagnosis of Cushing. Pheochromocytoma. This is also a cause for hypertension. Here the patient presents with an episodes of palpitation, profuse sweating, and headache. Usually, this paroxysms of palpitation, headache, and sweating will last for less than an hour. They may be because of an adrenal medulla tumor or tumor cells were in the body. The tumors are present in the adrenal medulla, you call it as a pheochromocytoma. They are present elsewhere, it's called as paragangliomas. may be familial and autosomal dominant, associated with multiple endocrine neoplasias, that is 2A and 2B, or may be associated with non-hypolendous disease and neurofibromatosis. So these are the conglomeration of syndromes may be associated with neochromocytoma. But classically, clinically, patient presents with paroxysms of palpitation, headache and profuse sweating, lasting for less than an hour. Can document hypertension and you can do diagnosis by means of urinary metanephrines. Then coming to the important urgency or emergency. The acute severe hypertension that is accompanied by a target organ injury is an emergency, because in this situation you have to bring down the hypertension probably in over a period of 2 hours to 6 hours to 24 hours. So reduce the chance of target organ injury. Minimize the chance of target injury. Because this is associated with morbidity and mortality, requires immediate inpatient intensive care treatment. This is called as hypertensive emergency. Then what is urgency? Here, there is also patient may present with high levels of blood pressure, may be asymptomatic, not associated with adverse short-term outcomes, can be managed as an outpatient. Then this emergency, what are the emergencies? For example, a stroke is a hypertensive emergency. Acute MI is a hypertensive emergency. An encephalopathy, hypertensive encephalopathy is an emergency. What is malignant hypertension? Is hypertensive encephalopathy, hypertensive nephropathy with hypertensive retinopathy is a malignant hypertension. So all these conditions, you have to control the blood pressure in a rapid way. So one important point you have to remember while treating a patient of hypertensive emergency is, in most of the patients, the auto regulation of various beds like cerebral circulation, plantar circulation, is set at a high level, both systolic and diastolic. It's set at a high level. So if you suddenly bring down to the less than the lower limit of the auto regulation, these patients will have some adverse effects. They may suffer from ischemia of the particular bed, maybe a cerebral circulation. They are more prone for damage. That is why when you are decreasing, when you are controlling the blood pressure in the case of an hypertensive emergency, you should be done in a controlled fashion. You should not target to reduce the blood pressure to more than 20 to 25% of mean arterial pressure, or you should not bring down to less than 160 by 110 within 2 hours. Then over a period of 6 to 24 hours, you must bring down to lesser levels. So when you are treating an emergency, keep in mind cerebral autoregulation. You should not bring down suddenly. You suddenly bring down to the less than lower limit of the autoregulation, the patient is more prone for an ischemic insult than by gradual reduction. How to reduce? The target is you can reduce to 20 to 25% of the mean arterial pressure, or don't bring down less than 160 by 110. Especially when the patient is in ischemic stroke, if the blood pressure is less than 220 by 130, you should not start immediately any antihypertensive treatment. This is an exception to all hypertensive emergencies. But whereas in some conditions like aortic dissection, where you have to bring down immediately within 2 hours. Then what is resistant hypertension? When do you call a resistant hypertension? You describe the patient as resistant hypertension when the treatment fails to bring to less than 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury after adequate treatment. That is, you have tried for 3 drugs, including a diuretic. Inadequate control of blood pressure is confirmed both by hospital as well as by recording by ambulatory or home blood pressure monitoring. Other causes for hypertension, like patient may be utilizing some other drugs which cause hypertension, alcohol consumption, etc., has also been excluded. That is, pseudo-resistant hypertension has been excluded. Secondary hypertension causes have been excluded. Then you cause this as a resistant hypertension. In resistant hypertension, probably you have to add as a fourth drug the aldosterone antagonist. That is, spironolactone can be tried. And if the patient is having GFR is less than 30, probably you have to go for loop diuretics also in this patient. So now, as a summary, you have to bring it's a step care type of treatment for patients who are having in stage 1. You have to go for lifestyle changes, and you can wait for a period of 2-3 months. It's not coming down, and if there is an there is a target organ damage, probably you have to start a monotherapy. If it's not coming down in 3 months, probably you have to add a second drug. Whereas in case of hypertension stage 2 and 3, you have to directly start 2 drugs. Not coming down in 3 months, probably you have to go for a third drug. How to choose them all? I told you, if it's less than 55, you can start with an ACE. More than 50 blockers. You can add diuretic or beta blocker or CC. Developments also. Which just I
will
and cardiovascular barrels. So by stimulating these carotid barrel receptors, they will send an inhibitory sympathetic stimuli which can reduce the blood pressure. So this mechanism has been utilized by using carotid barrel receptor stimulation by putting an implant or by means of an assistive device. This has also been tried, and in some of the cases of resistant hypertension, favorable effects are also been targeted, but still in trial. This is not the treatment. Renal denervation is one more treatment, and creation of a fistula between axillary vein and artery is also considered one treatment in patients where it's very resistant to treat. So these are all some of the recent developments. Just for the completion sake, I told you. So in summary, when a patient of hypertension comes, you have to establish a diagnosis. And for that, you should record the recording of hypertension, which I already told you, patient has to sit for a few minutes. At least once you have to record in both upper limbs and lower limbs, you have to take at least 2 recordings. Take an average. Highest recording, which arm you should remember, and for follow-up, that arm should be used. And when you have to grade the hypertension, identify and document target organ damage, then start treatment protocol. Before starting, if there is no target organ damage, if it is only a high normal or grade 1, probably you are justified in starting treatment with lifestyle changes. If there is a patient is overweight, patient is smoker, is having alcohol, other things, is consumption of salt, all these things can be, patient can be explained. All things if they are not able to control, if the cardiovascular risk is least, you can start on lifestyle changes. If there is a cardiac damage, probably in grade 1 also you are justified in starting either monotherapy and up titrating to stage 2 and stage 3 to a triple drug combination. How to track, how to select the drug, how to titrate the drug, I already told you. That how to treat in emergencies, where there is a crisis like blood pressure more than 225, 130 diastole. The conditions are seen in case of primary aldosteronism, pheochromocytoma, iatric dissection, post-MI, perioperative stage, all these things, how to control, how to do, I told you. So this is about hypertension. If you have any doubts,